I were a betting man, looking at the Soviet materials, as I have been privileged to do, I would guess that it is a Soviet judgment that war on a global scale in the next couple of decades is more likely than not. And Soviet strategic writings clearly suggest that if that is their view, the best way to avoid the worst consequences of war is to be prepared to wage it and to win it and to initiate it and to survive it. In the anti-ballistic missile area, some of us have been aware for 7 or 8 years of massive Soviet undertakings on a scale not equal since the original development of the atomic bomb to produce high-energy beamed weapon systems.
What is that?
Well, these are weapon systems whose purpose would be to neutralize intercontinental ballistic missiles, to be able to destroy them as they came toward you. The implications of such weapons, if they could be perfected, of course, by the Soviets, is that they would completely neutralize the American strategic deterrent. And the way you do this is to generate an enormous amount of electrical energy by explosive generation. And through a very intricate and very complex technology, you generate subatomic charged particles, in this case, say, heavy protons. And you produce these at such a rate and such intensity that upwards of tens of billions of electron volts of energy per pulse are fired against an object that may be a few miles away or thousands of miles away in space. Now, the energy potential of any such weapon goes beyond anything ever conceived in the United States in the last 25 years.
The weapon that General Keegan is talking about is said to be under development somewhere in southeastern Russia. It's probably being built at Semipalatinsk, where anti-ballistic warheads are tested. Perhaps within one of these silos, the beam would be housed. The power is provided by a nuclear explosion in a confined space below ground. The resultant electromagnetic energy is then contained in a magnetic straitjacket for small fractions of a second. The energy is stored, built up momentarily in a capacitor, and discharged as electrical energy. In turn, this is converted into a pulsed stream of electrons. American scientists have always assumed that the beam would simply spread and lose its power as it passed through the atmosphere. But the Russians may have solved this problem by introducing heavy protons into the stream of accelerating electrons. To aim the beam, a magnetic mirror has been developed by the Soviet scientists. A mirror that will steer the beam into the area of space it's meant to protect against incoming missiles. And the power of the weapon? A 1,000-ton explosion below ground would become a 100-ton explosion in space. In addition, the hot X-rays, neutrons, and gamma pulse effects of the beam would cause the missile to disintegrate from within. The principle of the high-energy beam is similar to that of a television tube. You see the TV picture because a magnet directs electrons to build up an image on the surface of the tube. As the beam scans space, it would form an impenetrable barrier for incoming intercontinental missiles. If it works, the present generation of American rockets would be useless. General Keegan.
The Soviets have been working at this for more than 20 years and have in fact succeeded in developing most of the supporting technologies, and that they may in fact be now experimentally testing such technology.
When you say may now be, do you believe that they are in fact ready to test this new weapon?
I believe they're testing it now. And if the Soviets don't blow themselves up, which they may, we're talking about very lethal amounts of energy, there is no reason to suppose that the Soviets by 1980 or before could believe that they have solved the problem of ballistic missile defense by a massive breakthrough in technology, which would represent an advance as great as was the development of the atom bomb itself.
Could it not be a colossal con, a colossal piece of Soviet disinformation?
There is not, in my judgment, the remotest possibility that that is the case. In the first place, Soviet security on this subject has been second to none. Secondly, the evidence that we have uncovered to date suggests an investment running into the tens of billions of rubles, an absolutely massive investment involving the best of Soviet science, the best of their laboratories, an effort which is on such an extraordinary scale that I can hardly conceive such a scale of effort being undertaken as a part of a deception process.
Could you be using me for a colossal piece of disinformation to try to persuade Congress to spend more money on the arms race?
I think that would be most unethical. It would be anathema to me and would represent something that I would simply abhor. I don't think you can succeed at this sort of business in the free world. I would not willingly or voluntarily be part of such an effort to deceive. And I am not at the present time. And my reason for discussing this is that we are running out of lead time. We don't have much time remaining to determine whether I am wrong or whether I am right. And I think it ought to be one of the high objectives of my government, at least, to determine as a matter of urgency whether I am right or whether I am wrong. Despite the expenditure of tens of billions of dollars since World War II to assure that the West would never again be faced with a surprise attack like Pearl Harbor, despite the vast and magnificent structure of intelligence which we have built in the free world, the fact of the matter is that all of the things that brought Pearl Harbor about are still with us.